Introduction as far as possible. The materials of the true history of anarcho-syndicalism in its human aspect should be provided, more important than the bureaucratic manifestations that have been so extensive. Only truthfulness can give the true dimension of what we were. The truth. The beautiful truth can only be appreciated if, next to it, as part of itself, there is also the ugly face of their truth. Joan Garcia Oliver. After the division within the labor movement between socialists and anarchists at the Congress of the International in The Hague in 1872 and, above all, after the outbreak of the Russian Revolution, the anarchist movement was beating in retreat before the socialist advance in almost everywhere. However, the same did not happen in the Iberian Peninsula where, both in Spain and Portugal, anarchism was always more numerous and stronger. Among the various reasons that explain this phenomenon we could mention, the Spanish anarchists understood the peasant problem long before the socialists and took root, from the earliest times, in Andalusia, the melting pot of the Spanish agrarian question. The anarchists established their main base in Barcelona, which was the industrial center of the country, while the socialists established it in Madrid, the bureaucratic capital of the nation, where the proletariat itself barely existed. Anarchists were formidable and tireless propagandists. They published newspapers, magazines, and brochures in abundance. At the beginning of the century, the weekly Diario y Libertad, which was published in Madrid, became a newspaper, undoubtedly being the first anarchist newspaper to be published in the world. The Sampareo Prometo publishing house in Valencia, directed by Blasco Ibáñez, published all the anarchist literature of the time at popular prices. The socialists never attached any special importance to printed propaganda and were content to publish three or four weeklies throughout the country. There, anarchists were more combative than the socialists. The peasant insurrections in Andalusia, in the last quarter of the last century, although elementary and mistaken most of the time, lit the flame of a longed-for liberation, whose embers, after the failure, never died. In the heat of that embers the humble peasants gathered and listened to the reading of the brochures of Malaita's To and Their Conquest of Bread by Kropotkin. The anarchists understood the importance of the education of the youth to train the fighters of tomorrow, and created the rationalist schools, whose main promoter, Francisco Ferrer, when he was shot in 1909, gave the anarchist saints a martyr with an international halo. The anarchists, persecuted without stopping, acquired the practice of acting in the shadows, in hiding, while the socialists tried not to violate the established laws. Anarchists practiced propaganda for the ego as a political weapon, and if in some cases the results were negative, in others they were positive. The anarchists, although the number of intellectuals who were part of their organizations was relatively lower, made an intelligent policy of attracting them, inviting them to collaborate in their magazines and newspapers. The so-called Generation of 98, which began a new phase in the intellectual life of Spain at the beginning of the century, was intuitively anarchist. The socialists, on the other hand, until the second decade of the century, distrusted the intellectuals, rejecting them. Anarchism, a bit mystical, quixotic, adventurous, individualistic, was much closer to the psychological characteristics of the Spanish people than socialism, cold, schematic, formulaic, disciplined, regulatory. The First World War determined a rapid industrial development in Catalonia, with the consequent growth of the labor movement, framed and directed by anarcho-syndicalism. The anarcho-syndicalists understood before the socialists the advisability of transforming trade unions into industrial unions. The appearance of the Sindicato Unico, industrial union, was revolutionary and gave the anarcho-syndicalists such a boost that the majority of the Spanish working class gravitated around the National Confederation of Labor. And last but not least, the anarchists gave evidence of an imagination that socialists have always lacked. The origin of the CNT is found in the 8th Regional Federation of Spanish, FRE, founded in 1870. The FRE lived through the debate between Marxists and anarchists raised within the 8th. But, While in the central institutions of the First International the Marxist current dominated, in the FRE the majority made up of syndicalists and anarchists was consolidated. Finally, the Madrid Marxist sector would be expelled from the FRE in 1872 and they constituted what they called the New Madrid Federation that, years later, would give rise to the SO. Circus Theatre, Barcelona. June 1870. First Congress of the FRE and First Labour Congress in Spain. With the disappearance of the Workers' International, the internal disputes and especially the repression carried out by the Restoration Government, put an end to the FRE, their first internationalist experience in Spain. In 1881 the Federation of Workers of the Spanish Region, FTRE, was founded, heir to the previous one and which experienced rapid growth. But it did not take long for the FTRE to be forced into hiding and to suffer the same fate as its predecessor. The harsh repression, especially in the Andalusian countryside, ended up dividing the federation. His heir was the Anarchist Organization of the Spanish Region, or AER, that acted from the underground and that would inaugurate in Spain what would be known as propaganda for the fact. This new period of anarchist attacks would last until the end of the 19th century, at which time a union reorganization would begin in the country. In 1907 the Catalan Union Solidaridad Obrera was formed, which collected their remnants of the internationalist spirit as well as the proposals of French revolutionary unionism contained in the Charter of Mons. Both currents became one to end up becoming what would later be known as anarcho-syndicalism. Finally, in November 1910 Solidaridad Obrera convened a National Workers' Congress at the Fine Arts Theatre in Barcelona. In this election, it was approved to transcend their Catalan regional sphere into a Spanish state sphere under the name of the National Labour Confederation, CNT. The objective was none other than to hasten the economic emancipation of the working class through the revolutionary expropriation of the bourgeoisie. The CNT started out small, with around 30,000 members through various unions and other confederations. Its growth was rapid, although it was constantly marked by long periods of secrecy that weakened the organization. On the other hand, the data referring to the remaining congresses, from 1911 to 1936, refer to the number of affiliates by geographical area. There may be some numerical mismatch that is not important for the overall analysis of total CNT membership. In 1911, on the occasion of its first congress, a general strike was called, which caused the union to be outlawed until 1914. From 1916, the CNT changed its strategy with respect to the UGT, establishing relations with this union, which led to both organizations jointly call the General Strike of 1917. But the action of the UGT during its development showed for a good part of the libertarians that the UGTista leadership, although interested in social pressure to achieve its objectives, would never exceed the parliamentary limits that channeled the workers along paths acceptable to the bourgeoisie. The outbreak of World War I favored the development of the Spanish economy and produced enormous benefits for large industrialists and the agricultural sector. During this period, the bosses acceded with relative ease to workers' demands for better wages. This efficiency of the unions brought in these great masses, who saw in them a weapon to wrest improvements from the employers and to defend themselves, at the same time, from the upward movement of prices. The CNT had 15,000 members in 1915, and by the end of 1919 it had numbered 714,000. For the bourgeoisie, anarcho-syndicalism was becoming a clear threat to the social order that sustained its social and economic hegemony. The litmus test between the two began on February 5, 1919 with the Canadian conflict in Barcelona, a mythical strike in the history of libertarian unionism due to its importance, duration and dimensions. The strike would conclude with a fairly favorable balance for the workers, 8-hour workday, salary improvements, reinstatement of the dismissed and freedom for their detainees. Demonstration against the high cost of living. 1916. At that time, panic began to spread among the bosses, which gave rise to the gunfighting that led to a rise in violence, especially in the streets of Barcelona. The social class struggle had become the great problem for the ruling classes of the country. This spiral of violence and gunmen, initiated by the bosses and to which the CNT responded, would last until the end of 1923 with the coup by Primo de Rivera and would mean the Union's return to secrecy. After the fall of the dictator in 1930, the CNT returned to legality and the unions and local and regional structures were reorganized with enormous force throughout the Spanish geography. Contrary to the predictions of Primo de Rivera, anarcho-syndicalism had survived his mandate, as it already happened in the last century, when the death of the Spanish International was officially certified. On April 14, 1931, the Second Republic was proclaimed in Spain. Shortly after, Largo Caballero, Minister of Labor and Secretary General of the UGT, implanted the mixed juries, which were nothing but the joint committees of the dictatorship, a structure analogous to the current works councils. Largo Caballero's labor laws placed the CNT at a clear disadvantage compared to the UGT, since this decree outlawed the Confederation, the majority sector of the organized Spanish proletariat, for going against its most basic principles. Any difference between workers and employers had to be previously arbitrated and, on the other hand, that provision, clearly directed against anarcho-syndicalism, tended to suppress the right to strike. The working masses quickly understood that the new regime would not succeed in fulfilling their reasonable aspirations. Since 1931, a revolutionary atmosphere spread in the unions that the moderate militancy, with Angel Pestana at the head, tried to stop with the publication in August 1931 of the Manifesto of the 30. The political parties received their manifesto with satisfaction. They had always tended to bridle the Confederacy, to always make it enter through the channels that suited political interests, and if this failed, then the policy of extermination was put into operation. Catalan politicians, above all, judged the occasion favorable and had an influence to explode the budding schism. The 30s began to be displaced from all their organic responsibilities. The Sabadell unions, with more than 20,000 members and supporters of Trentismo, were expelled from the Confederation. This fact led to the split that originated the so-called opposition unions. The larvae reformist process of Pestana, already outside the CNT, revealed all its importance in the final climax, with the creation at the end of 1932 of the Syndicalist Party, which, on the other hand, aspiring to become the motor and inspiration of the union's workers, would confirm the thesis of his opponents. The Syndicalist Party marked a formal break with anarchism and its evolution towards a political unionism inspired by English labor. Already around this time, coinciding with the fall of the 30s, the Confederal Defense Guards were created, with the idea of endowing anarcho-syndicalism with a paramilitary apparatus with which, in its day, to be able to defeat the armed forces victoriously. The Defense Guards, organized territorially in very delimited areas with respect to other groups, made up of 6 members, with very precise informational, espionage and investigative tasks, were the CNT's primary clandestine armed organization. The CNT, exasperated by the monopolizing policy of the socialists in the Ministry of Labor, began an insurrectionary phase to attack a republican regime that had proposed to neutralize anarcho-syndicalism. It was then that the so-called revolutionary gymnastics began to be talked about. The strikes, riots and assaults that culminated in the proclamation of libertarian communism took place in various parts of their country over the coming years. Special mention should be made of the events of Casas Viejas in 1933. The massacre carried out by the civil guard, mandated by the republican government, was lavish in consequences. Knowing the facts in the rest of the country, there was a great journalistic and parliamentary scandal, which ended up causing the fall of Manuel Azaña as president of the Council of Ministers, as well as the discrediting of the republican government by the popular classes. Moment in which they count those executed in Casas Viejas. Thus the first experience of government by Spanish socialism would be settled, which had persecuted it tenaciously through long and tedious years of parliamentary history. The crisis of the radical socialist government caused the calling of new general elections for November 1933 that gave a wide victory to the right. Anarcho-syndicalism was attending with attention to the evolution of socialism, which had been thrown from power and was indulging in bitter lamentations. Evicted, the socialists now thought of the revolution. But the CNT did not forget its management in the government. In this context, the October 1934 revolution took place, which mainly took place in Asturias and a little in Catalonia, where the CNT actively participated. In the rest of Spain there were only sporadic strikes and violence. The repression was at the height of the greatest repressions of all times. The mining companies laid off the workers en masse and only admitted them after prior purging. There were numerous executions and the more than 20,000 people went to jails. The breadth of the Asturias movement, while achieving the objective of breaking the radical CEDista government, undoubtedly exceeded the forecasts of the socialist strategists. Finally, the February 1936 elections gave victory to the Popular Front and Aznar was named President of the Republic. Soon rumors began to spread about the preparation of a state coup. Meanwhile, strikes and land occupations by peasants increased, to which the government responded by sending its forces to repress them. Also in large cities numerous strikes broke out from May to June. Especially important was the construction strike in Madrid in June, to which 100,000 workers would end up joining. The momentum gained by the CNT in Madrid was, at the time, impressive. The growth of the Confederacy was at the expense of the UGTist unions. July 17, 1936, the Northern Moroccan Army and various peninsular garrisons staged a coup. Political power, impotent, frightened, atomized, was picked up by the people on the same street. On July 19 the uprising would reach Barcelona, where in 33 hours the working class would put down the fascist uprising. The victory was widely celebrated in the city of Barcelona. At the same time, the people, who had seized arms, launched a social revolution with the CNT FEI at the head. Armed groups moved throughout the region and Tarragona, Girona and Lleida followed the fate of Barcelona. The CNT and the FEI remained absolute masters of the life of Catalonia, thus beginning what would go down in history as the Spanish Social Revolution. However, after rejecting the proposal of García Oliva and the comical Delbajo Llobregat to go for everything, the Central Committee of Anti-Fascist Militias was created, made up of all the left forces in Catalonia, and which went on to become a body parallel to a phantom government of the Generalitat. In any case, although it had not been approved to go for the whole, the fact is that the Catalan working class, impatient, launched itself into the collectivization of the land and the means of production. July 19, 1936. The people in arms. 48 hours after the uprising, the country was divided into two zones. In general, the agrarian provinces, Galicia, Castilla, Leon, Aragon, Navarra and Andalusia, remained in the power of the nationals, while Catalonia, Levante, Asturias, the Basque Country and Madrid under the dominion of the Republic. In Catalonia, on July 24, the Durruti Column, made up of some 2,500 militiamen, left Barcelona and headed for Zaragoza, with the aim of liberating the city from the fascist yoke and thus spreading the social revolution. But the degree of militarization of the popular militias produced great discontent among the volunteer militiamen. After long and bitter discussions, part of the militiamen left the fronts. In February 1937 an assembly of confederal columns was held that addressed the question of militarization. The threats not to supply arms, food, or soldiers to the columns that did not accept militarization, added to the conviction that the militiamen would be integrated into other units, already militarized, had an effect. The ideology of anti-fascist unity and the collaboration of the CNT FEI in governmental tasks, in defense of the Republican state, triumphed against the resistance to militarization. New mistake that Spanish anarchism would pay dearly for. On November 4, 1936, once the Committee of Anti-Fascist Militias had been dissolved, the CNT entered the Republican government of Largo Caballero, being the incumbents designated by the CNT itself, Juan Garcia Oliva, Minister of Justice, Federica Montseny, Health, Juan Piro, Industry, and Juan López, Commerce. Naturally, there were many criticisms that came from foreign anarchism and anarcho-syndicalism, as well as many internal opposition to the governmental attitude of the CNT, but neither did the opponents manage to point out a convincing alternative for the confederal mass. And in reality, there was also an unconfessed complicity in many militant enemies of the collaboration, who criticized at the same time as they left to do. The circumstances imposed by an implacable war gradually determined the absorption by the state of the popular organs created by the revolutionary impulse. He would try to control them first, then frame them in legality and finally brutally destroy them. Despite the many projects and decrees promulgated by the four anarchist ministers, the reality is that his work in the government was very limited by the short duration of his mandate, which did not reach a semester. The Communist Party had already been planning the assault on the executive power for some time, and in May 1937 Negrín was placed at the head of the executive, to the detriment of Largo Caballero. CNT FEI militiamen. From then on, the advance of Stalinism was unstoppable. Already the conflictive situation between the tendencies that proposed the revolution by the base, the anarchists and the CNT, and the conquest of political power by the top, the communists, the PCE and the SUC, culminated on May 2 with the surprise attack in Barcelona by 200 units of the assault forces commanded by the communist leaderships on the Telefonica building, an entity that was seized by the CNT. Thus began a confrontation in the streets of the city between the CNT FEI and the PUM, on the one hand, and the SUC and the UGT on the other. The CNT committees tried to demonstrate the excessive duties of the Minister of Internal Security and, meanwhile, the CNT FEI radio station broadcast incessantly propaganda aimed at imposing a ceasefire. These proclamations stopped the offensive impulse of the rank and file guardas, puzzled by the conciliatory attitude of the responsible committees. These vacillations were taken advantage of by his enemies to conquer new positions. At last appeasement was achieved, and the CNT believed, or wanted to believe, in the visuality of that peace, but the truth was that from that moment on, the balance of political forces in Catalonia was defeated on the side of the SUC and the Generalitat. The Republican-Stalinist counter-revolution had triumphed, and a new coalition government was formed, in an attempt to maintain the fiction of unity, always chaired by campaigners. This would affect the development of the conflict throughout the country, and the anti-fascist unit would henceforth remain a mere subject for propaganda and partisan proselytism. As a result of the events of May, the destruction of the peasant communities, which were militarily assaulted, was decreed. The collectivists' lands and tools were handed over to the expropriated old owners. More than 600 CNT militants were arrested, among them dead and wounded, and more than 1,000 had to emigrate to other regions or seek refuge in friendly trenches. These events marked the end of the social revolution and the beginning of Stalinist hegemony in the sphere of the Republic, a counter-revolution carried out by the Communist Parties, PCE SUC, led by Dolores Ibarruri, La Pagan Area, and Santiago Carrillo, in turn remote controlled from Moscow. The Spanish Revolution had been destroyed, and Stalinism became hegemonic in that bourgeois republic that, paradoxically, lacked bourgeois social support, since the great Catalan and Basque bourgeoisie had joined the military uprising and installed in Burgos, the seat of fascism that would have to finally triumph under the leadership of the genocidal Francisco Franco. The collectivist experience that took place in Catalonia between July 1936 and January 1939, despite the fact that it could not fully achieve its objectives due to the constraints and difficulties it had to face, constitutes one of the most radical transformations of the 20th century. Transformation that affected all aspects of political, economic, social and cultural life not only in the region but also in the entire country. On December 26, 1938, Catalonia fell. The rearguard of the area, hungry and demoralized, was resigned to defeat. On February 10, the National Army occupied the last stretch of the Pyrenees, thus closing the borders. On February 27, 1939, Azana resigned from the presidency of the Republic, and on March 4, Negrin and the communist leaders left Spain. Then the conditions set by the government of General Franco were known: total surrender. There was no negotiation possible. From then on, the Republican zone lived like a nightmare. Port of Alicante. April 1, 1939, end of the war. Concentration of Italian fascist troops. They all look towards the Malecan, where, after a chaotic review of abandoned vehicles and the smoke from the fires of the fugitives, a human mass is glimpsed. They are the 20,000 Republicans who had taken refuge in the narrowness of the pier waiting Varna that one of the many ships so many times promised approached the port to embark anywhere in search of salvation. On April 1, 1939, the National Army issued the last part. The civil war had ended, giving way to the establishment of a fascist regime with Francisco Franco, the self-erected Caudillo of Spain, who during their first years would put special emphasis on persecuting and exterminating political dissidents. The war was over, but peace had not come. Nor would it arrive. The exile of the refugees was very diverse. The least got a ticket to Latin America. France was the seat of the great mass of emigrants, followed later by England and North Africa, already in a lesser tone. Those who had the guarantee of a relative or a friend could leave the refugee camps in France and find a job to alleviate their misery. Many others went to the fields and to the gigantic hydraulic works, barrages, then underway in the neighboring country. Many others went to enlist in the Foreign Legion or the battalions of workers. In November 1941, under the gaze of the Gestapo, Hitler's troops had already taken France. There, men of the barrage formed the organizing commission of the Spanish Libertarian Movement in France, which brought together men from the three branches, CNT, FAI, FIGE. The reorganization extended to the free and occupied zones, reaching over time to all parts of the country. Shortly before the Allied landing on the Normandy beach, the entire CNT was organized in France. The CNT continued being, by the number of its militants and activity, the most important organization of the Republican exile. But after the end of World War II, the majority sector closed the period of collaboration and governmentalism, which was opposed by a minority. This ended up generating a split in exile into two branches that would not reunify until 1960. In the interior, the repression exercised by the Franco regime during the first years was bloody. Between 1939 and 1944, a total of 190,694 people were shot. This was not an impediment for the CNT to begin to reorganize itself in the interior in 1939. The national committees fell constantly, but despite this, the Confederation experienced a small boom, remaining practically a structure throughout Spain. The agitation began in the university, the hand blows of the guerrillas of El Maqui and the struggles of the urban guerrillas in Barcelona, encouraged by the libertarian movement in exile. However, at the end of the World War, it had already become clear that the Western powers were not going to intervene in Spain, so the repression of the regime intensified from 1947 on. The CNT in the interior began its decline, gradually dying out. In 1961, a secret body was created from exile, known as Internal Defense, DI, with the aim of boosting the armed and conspiratorial action against Francoism, and whose main objective was the elimination of General Franco. DI was made up of four well-known exiled militants in Europe, two in America and one in Africa. By the CNT in Europe, Acracio Ruiz and Cipriano Mera, for the FAI and representing the libertarian exile in America and Europe respectively, Juan Garcia Oliver and Germano Escalés, for the FIGEL, Octavio Albarola, and representing the CNT in Africa, Juan Jimeno. Soon the first actions were carried out. In June 1961, explosive devices exploded in Madrid, to later carry out similar acts in Valencia and Barcelona and culminate in August with explosions in the Valley of the Fallen and in San Sebastian, near Franco's summer residence. However, the pressure of the French authorities and the collaboration of the police of both countries were making DI's action more difficult, which would eventually disappear. Still, the decade from 1955 to 1965 was actually a dark time for Spanish anarcho-syndicalism, and not a few predicted, once again, its extinction. But with the gradual fall of their regime, the CNT began its reconstruction. In the summer of 1975, the feeling of the regime's collapse was pervasive. Finally, the dictator would die in Madrid on November 20, 1975. After his death, the succession mechanisms worked as the dictator had left tied and well tied, and Juan Carlos de Bourbon was invested as king on November 22 of the same year, being accepted with skepticism both by supporters of the regime and by the democratic opposition. Thus began the process known as the Spanish Transition and its, not so mentioned, dirty war. On May 6, 1977, the National Labour Confederation was legalized, which contributed to its development. The CNT, the last trade union organization to be legalized, confirmed its revolutionary classicism at this stage. It rejected contacts or compromises with the state or with the businessmen at the top. During these months, an invitation to dialogue with the Minister of Trade Union Relations and another to participate in the ILO, International Labour Organization, was declined due to its intergovernmental and clearly anti-worker nature. In a short time, the failure of the break with the Franco regime and the domestication of the unions became evident. Thus, the feeling of betrayal and defeat grew among the most combative militants of the working class, especially among those affiliated with the communist parties who, irritated and disappointed, ended up in the unions of the CNT, which maintained a radical and anti-political discourse in that they recognized themselves. In just a few months, the CNT unions grew in number and membership, but, in return, were reinforced by members outside of anarcho-syndicalism. In any case, the CNT was already a fully consolidated union, which could be seen at the meetings in San Sebastián de los Reyes or in Montjuïc, which brought together more than 200,000 people. Mitin de la CNT en Montjuïc. Barcelona. 2 de julio de 1977. Todo pecha apunta a un gran renacimiento de la CNT, no solo como organización sindical, también como aglutinante de un importante movimiento libertario que conectaba con un amplio movimiento social contestatario. La CNT pecha reviva pasando factura a casi 40 años de dictadura y de falta de libertades, encabezando los ángeles, las ansias de libertad y los deseos de cambios radicales y en profundidad de amplios sectores de la población española. En medio de una fuerte conflictividad social tuvo lugar en octubre de 1977 la firma de los pactos de la Moncloa. Estos acuerdos fueron firmados entre el gobierno de España, precedido por Adolfo Serres y los principales partidos políticos con representación parlamentaria en el Congreso de los Diputados. Los pactos supusieron la imposición definitiva de la reforma política sobre la ruptura con el franquismo. Si la futura Constitución tenía una gran importancia en lo que se refirió a establecer las reglas básicas del juego político, el pacto social tendría una importancia también trascendental, ya que sería lo que permitiría reconstruir la paz social y la disciplina en el mundo del trabajo español. Algo sin duda imprescindible en un país en donde la clase obrera había adquirido una gran capacidad de autoorganización capaz de sobrepasar a comités y burocracias sindicales. Había que restablecer una situación de asentamiento, Impressionable para affrontar una crisis económica que se pensaba resolver con anarquist juro que, por supuesto, debían pagar los trabajadores. Por lo tanto, una parte fundamental de los pactos de la Moncloa era como controlar el movimiento obrero y los sindicatos al margen de QUGT, es decir, a la CNT. Fue aquí por lo tanto don se creó y preparó la colaboración de clases, concertación social, para lo que se tomó como ejemplo la socialdemocracia alemana. Asanasen los camites de empresa, sindicalismo de un voto tipo, nefastos para la lucha no solo en lo económico, sino también en lo organizativo y unitario como clase, ya que partializaban las luchas, empresa por empresa. Cuando las luchas y las vindicaciones eran globales. En realidad, los camites de empresa eran, y son, de naturaleza antisindical, puesto que la actividad sindical solo consistía en depositar un voto en una urna cada 4 años, y los trabajadores supuestamente representados en su conjunto por el camite no sentían la necesidad de organizarse para luchar por sus intereses. Al poco tiempo UGTY que aceptaron firmar el documento y la CNT pasó a ser el único gran sindicato que nucleaba un frente contra el pacto social en el que se agrupaba buena parte de la izquierda radical, otros sindicatos de corte asambleario y algunos movimientos sociales. Pero lo que convertía a la CNT en un peligro potencial no era su fuerza en aquel momento, sino su posible capacidad para, en causa el discontento social que inevitablemente iba a producirse. El 15 de enero de 1978 la CNT organizó una manifestación en Barcelona contra la firma de los pactos de la Moncloa y las elecciones sindicales. En la misma se juntaron alrededor de 10.000 trabajadores que seguían oponiendo su aspecto social y que era prueba evidente de la gran capacidad de convocatoria que tenía la CNT en aquellos momentos. Terminada la manifestación, tuvo lugar un ataque con cócteles Molotov contra la sala de fiestas más conocida y de más éxito de Barcelona en aquellos momentos, la Sala Scala. El resultado inmediato fue la muerte de 4 trabajadores de la sala, 3 de los cuales eran afiliados de la propia CNT. La duda y la incredulidad siguió siendo la tónica general hasta que, tan solo, 48 horas después, un comunicado de la policía informó de la detención de todos los presuntos autores del atentado, a quien inmediatamente se le relacionó con la CNT. En los días posteriores fueron detenidas alrededor de 170 personas más, al mismo tiempo que se desataba una imponente campana de descrédito contra la organización confederal por medio de los medios de comunicación y de los aparatos represivos del Estado, que vieron la ocasión de amordaza y destruir la única fuerza con cierto peso social que amenazaba amplia operación de blanqueo de la dictadura franquista y de los propios franquistas, los pactos de la Moncloa. Un superscripto de mayo de 1976. Manifestación en Madrid. El tiempo demostraría que el atentado producto de un monte policial orquestado mediante confidence. Infiltrados en el sindicato y la infiltración del confidente, Joaquín Gambin, quien había dirigido el atentado. Pero ya era demasiado tarde, el caso Scala marcó el fin del crecimiento espectacular de la CNT y del movimiento libertario en general, y el inicio de su decadencia acelerada. Supuso el frenazo de una organización que creció a Joe's Vista. El asentimiento de sus divisiones y un descredito, que arrastró la organización confederal que quedó ampliamente desautorizada socialmente y prácticamente neutralizada, se consumó el gran pacto de estado de la transición y de la nueva democracia española, sin oponentes. El periodo into 1979 years 1983 Este marcado por la secesión es que sufrió lanico sindical. Producto de la postura mantenida por parte de los sectores minoritarios en favor de participar en las elecciones sindicales o comites de empresa, copia sin redox de los jurados mixtos, los comites paritarios y los jurados de empresa que siempre rechazó la gente y que fueron causa de su marginación con la dictadura de Primo de Rivera y con la Segunda República y motivo de exclusión de la lucha sindical en el seno de la CNS Franquista. Es importante señalar que estas decisiones no se habrían producido sin la intervención estela del gobierno del deseoso de hacer pasar a la gente por el aro del sindicalismo institucionalizado. Alfonso Guerra, vicepresidente del gobierno, legó a mantener reuniones secretas con José Bondia, entonces secretario general de la gente. Al que le hizo una serie de suculentas promesas que ponían sobre la mesa una auténtica oferta de compra de la gente. Producto de estas decisiones como resultado del entramado gubernamental fue la creación de la CGT, organización que añadía homenaje su misión de tratar institucional es el sindicalismo revolucionario y en causa la rebeldía de la clase trabajadora. Tal y como el so habia esperado. La Confederación Nacional del Trabajo habia tomado sus esencias, pero no sin pagar un alto precio, una dolorosa ruptura sindical, una considerable pedido de militantes y una sensación de amargo desencanto que tardaría en supera. Tras el calvario vivido a lo largo de la década de los 90. Época en la que se podría destacar las luchas por la recuperación del patrimonio sindical histórico, la gente entró en el siglo XXI exhausta. Fue entonces cuando comenzó a experimentar un crecimiento. Enmarcado dentro de un contexto de revitalización del anarquismo a nivel global, especialmente en los últimos tres o cuatro años. Un que se puede constatar si examinamos el notable incremento de conflictos liberales y la creación de nuevos núcleos y sindicatos confederales en diversos